Hello, Malty Monster Boards. Ralphie here with Whiskey Review 345. Yes, here we are. Lights, camera, and action. Here we are. Mm-hmm. Here's the pouring action. I'm well practiced at this, as you can imagine. Oh, isn't that lovely? Here it is, maltmates. Tullamore Dew. But before we start to review this particular Irish whiskey, I've got to give credit for the malt mention, and credit goes to Kinkerswidgen 345. No, 345 is the number of the whiskey review. Forget that bit. I put them too close together. Kinkerswidgen. Yeah. There's some names I do find it a little bit of a challenge to pronounce. I think I'll call it quits now and just move on into the review. Right, here we are, a short series on Irish whiskey. Because St. Patrick's Day is taking place in about 2 weeks' time, which gives me either 4 or 5 reviews between now and then, because we're in the beginning of March 2013 here. And so a little series, a mini series in Irish whiskies, in which I'm going to go into a little bit more detail, a bit more depth than I did first time round a couple of years ago when I reviewed Bushmills and Jamesons. A fairly ubiquitous but understandable start when you're introducing and discussing Irish whiskies. But I want to kind of spread the net a little bit, because unlike Scotch distilleries, which are over 100 single malt distilleries in Scotland, in Ireland, if back in the 19th century, well, sure, there was hundreds of distilleries then, and many of them were producing really good stuff with a sound international reputation. But by the beginning of the 20th century, there were only 60 distilleries. Now, it sounds quite a lot, but compared to what there had been, only 60 distilleries left in Ireland. And then you look at Ireland. Now, how many distilleries does Ireland have? You can count them literally in one hand. Bushmills, Jamesons, Cooley, Kilbeggan, Dingle. Oh, Jamesons, of course, being Middleton. And I want to kind of discuss why this is. But I'll review this Tullamore Dew first. This is the basic version. It tends to be the popular and available option if you're not keen on Bushmills and you want a change from Jamesons. Now, both Bushmills and Jamesons are very easy drinking whiskies, and they have their own kind of subtle understated complexity. You know, we're not talking peat monsters here. We're talking about a different style, the Irish style, which is softer. It has more green notes in it, particularly if it's pot still whiskey, which is a combination of malted and unmalted barley, which came about completely by accident. It was never particularly planned that way by some master genius. It was to do with taxes on malted barley back in the 18th century. In fact, there was riots in England as regards malt tax. To be honest, there's not quite riots nowadays, but wherever you are in the world, you can see how the governments tend to plunder alcohol as a source of revenue quite heavily. Anyway, enough of that for the moment. Back to the Tullamore Dew. Produced by Jamesons at Middleton Distillery for William Grant and Sons, the Scotch whisky producers, although I am aware that William Grant's are planning to open a distillery in Tullamore, which is a town right in the centre of Ireland. Quite an attractive spot, quite near Kilbeggan Distillery, which in my opinion is the most authentic interesting Irish distillery to visit if you happen to be in Ireland. It very much follows the formula set by Bushmills and Jamesons. It's very light on the nose, it's soft grain, creamy, loads of vanilla, some nice slightly minty honey. I've got, for the nose, green vanilla, soft ginger, camphor, mild honey, cask char, a little bit of that almost charcoal from cask in there, suggesting bourbon, of course, and icing sugar, some mild gentle golden syrup, and if you add a drop of water, the whole experience just gets a little bit weaker. So this is one whiskey which is bottled at 40% that I recommend, is it, yeah, 40% volume. I recommend you don't actually add any water to it because it doesn't really help it much. Taste. Clean, fresh, slightly dry, crisp, green apple, creamy citrus, corn, big vanilla, quite significant amounts of vanilla. I mean, it's not quite Sailor Jerry, old recipe Sailor Jerry vanilla we're talking here, but it is seriously prominent. Rose water, some mild wood bitters and grain bitters. White bread in the taste, particularly towards the finish, in the latter half of the development, you're getting a kind of slightly doughy taste. And if you add water, you'll get a growing soft sour grain note. The finish is pretty swift and slightly vanilla. Marks out of 100. out of 100, and that is a blend. Don't get me wrong, I'm enjoying this, but okay, I'm going to get a wee bit controversial here. We don't really see many examples of old school dramatic Irish whiskey of the likes that got produced in the 1920s, when they were much more crisp and sour notes and mentholy and phenolic. Modern Irish whiskey is kind of easy drinking. And this is a very good example of that, and I'll tell you why. Because Irish whiskey is utterly dominated by corporate multinationals. Diageo own Bushmills, Pernod Ricard own Middleton, Jameson's, and Jim Beam Brands now own Cooley, which in my opinion is a real shame. What Ireland singularly lacks is a variety of small independent craft distilleries which would showcase much more variety of the provenance that Irish whiskey can have. You've got Dingle. It's about the only example of a small independent Irish distillery, and as far as I am aware, they're going to be bringing out the first of their whiskey in about 2015. If the very steep prices that they're asking for their initial cask sales or anything to go by, it may well be expensive stuff. If you go to Dingle Distillery's website, they do offer cask sales. You know, and it's highly unusual to have the opportunity to own your own cask of Irish whiskey. But I do recommend you take a long, hard look at the price, because it will wipe the smile off your face. Simple as that. Enough said. It's what we call in the what they would call in the in any business, not really a good publicity start. In terms of independent Irish distilleries, there's very few. They're virtually non-existent, and because Irish whiskey is so dominated by corporate multinationals, it's understanding these organisations. They're huge producers, not big, they're huge. I mean, Jamesons at Middleton are producing 19 million litres of spirit a year. That's a huge volume. And this spirit is going all around the world. And bear in mind, tastes differ when you go around the world. Therefore, in order to get the sales, in order for the product to appeal in all different countries and all different locations, big corporations, because they need the volume of sales, need as a necessity, as part of their business, they need to make their product as palatable and as acceptable to as wide a range of people as possible. So there's no point in producing bitter whiskey, which would be very pleasant if you're in Ireland, if you're in Scotland, when you know it's not going to sell in the Far East, which is a very important market. And of course, Americans, my goodness, there's a nation of folk who have a sweet tooth. I was visiting America a few years ago. Brief distraction, by the way. I was in Las Vegas, and it's fascinating to watch people eating in restaurants. What really got me was the lady who piled 5 large pancakes onto her plate, poured over the golden syrup, and then added ladles of melted butter. As they say, you know, travel broadens your horizons. And America is no exception. Fascinating, interesting place, and such a tremendous variation in culture across America. But when it comes to diet and food, it's very much sweet orientated, and therefore there's no point. You're not going to sell bitter whiskey or sour, excessively sour whiskey, challenging whiskey, and therefore for the big corporations, they've got to keep it accessible. And because of that, we don't really see many examples of more challenging traditional Irish whiskey. Connemara goes up to a certain extent, but there's one come out recently, which I'll be reviewing next, from Cooley Distillery when it was independent. I mean, you cannot underestimate how important Cooley Distillery has been for Irish whiskey. I just wish it had remained independent. But there we go, that's real life. So my next whiskey I'll be reviewing will be Greenore. Now this is an Irish whiskey which is fairly new. It's not like Tullamore Dew. Tullamore Dew, incidentally, is a revived brand. You know, this is one of the old labels, the old Irish whiskey names, which has been resurrected and given a much more modern interpretation. Tullamore, of course, after the town, and Dew is after, for those perhaps whose English is your second language, the dew refers to the moisture that gathers in the heather and the grass and the gorse first thing in the morning and is considered the purest of water. And there you have it. I feel this review's turned a little bit rambly, so I hope I'm not pushing it. I'm going to conclude by saying that as an introduction to Irish whiskey, Bushmills, Jamesons, Tullamore Dew, these are big, big brands, and they're a good place to start. But there's more to Irish whiskey than that. Pot Still, for example, is very interesting, and I'm going to second guess this, but I think there'll be a number of the new craft distilleries in the United States are going to be making their own American pot still, American Irish pot still whiskey. Now that will be interesting because it will be done sympathetically. I think it will probably be done enthusiastically and professionally. And that may well be our opportunity to try Irish craft whiskey from the United States. Because one thing does stand out, and that is that Ireland, at this moment in time, a lot of unemployment, a lot of distress going on because of the situation with the economy, craft distilleries would be ideal. The jobs created, the money from selling a product which is definitively Irish, the duty to the government to help pay for public services, and yet no sign. But I'm sure there's a reason for that. Anyway, review done and dusted. I hope you found this interesting, and I hope you'll join me again shortly when I plunk a bottle of Greenore 8-year-old single grain whiskey on the barrel and tell you all about it. Thanks for watching now.